Good morning, everybody. Welcome behind the scenes here at Jamie Riddler Studios. I am Jamie, and it is Friday. So did you catch me live on Wednesday? That was so much fun to do. Our power was going out early on in the day, so I thought I'm just going to go straight to YouTube and try streaming live, which I had never done there before, and it worked out quite well. I hope that you enjoyed it. I've been thinking about it a lot, thinking that this might be something I do on a regular basis, and wondering what it would be like to try that for a season. So I might try it, let's say, the last BTS of every month, for sure, I think. And you like that one? For sure, I think, maybe I might. Sometimes I talk like that when I know what I'm going to do, but I haven't quite worked my way up to admitting it yet. For sure, I'm going to do a YouTube Live at least once a month. And I was just thinking about what would it be like to do it for the rest of the summer. I got some books. I didn't get a chance to do a Creative Living bookshelf this week, so I'm going to move that to next week. It's a show that I love to do about the books that are on my nightstand, the ones that I'm reading. But this week, Justin has been away in Curacao visiting his dad, who has a friend there. I couldn't concentrate on anything except him coming home yesterday. So I didn't go with the video, but I do have a couple of books to share with you. I literally just got them. They were sent to me by New World Library, so thank you so much, Kim, for sending me those. And one is The Story You Need to Tell, Writing to Heal from Trauma, Illness, or Loss by Sandra Marinella. And I'll just read you the back. A practical and inspiring guide to transformational personal storytelling, The Story You Need to Tell is the product of Sandra Marinella's pioneering work with veterans and cancer patients, her years of teaching writing, and her research into its profound healing properties. Riveting true stories illustrate Marinella's methods for understanding, telling, and editing personal stories in ways that foster resilience and renewal. She also shares her own experience of using journaling and expressive writing to navigate challenges, including breast cancer and postpartum depression. Each of the techniques, prompts, and exercises she presents helps us to unravel the knot inside and to make sense of loss. So I'm looking forward to this, especially I love that balance between deep personal work and practical exercises and prompts to do. So I'm sure this will show up on the Creative Living bookshelf once I've had a chance to look into it more deeply, but I wanted to share it with you because it just arrived. So, and then I've got Start Where You Are by Sam Bennett. Now, I recently heard Sam on Tranquility Du Jour, Kimberly Wilson's podcast. So you can dive over there if this sounds interesting to you and you already want to get more. So the back says, what are you waiting for? An overwhelmed procrastinator, frustrated overachiever, and recovering perfectionist herself, Sam Bennett knows all the ways we avoid pursuing our dreams and reaching our goals. She also knows how to get it done. Start Right Where You Are is an easy-to-read, easy-to-do guidebook for anyone who wants to change their life but doesn't know where or how to begin. I was interested in some of the chapter titles, like You're Not Thinking What You Think You're Thinking, or New Thoughts Versus Old Tapes. That's familiar. You know, we were talking this week about our personal story, our hypotheses about our life and how we might change them. Have you thought about that? Have you paid attention to the hypotheses you're running with and maybe pick some that might serve you better? I hope so. So I am curious to read more of Sam's book. And again, I'll let you know how I find it. I've been really trying to take more time for reading. And this summer, I'm even going to try to take some more time for reading fiction. I think I end up reading about one fiction book a year because I am diving into so many other books, and particularly nonfiction and recently memoirs. I just can't get enough of them. Do you have any memoirs that you love, that you would recommend to me? I would love to hear it. And is memoir something you have been thinking about? So we've been talking about our stories in a few different ways, like what are our hypotheses? What are the stories we tell about our life, and how do we make them come true by believing a certain premise? And if you're a member of the studio, and I hope you are, and if you're not, hop on by to openthedoor.ca and join. It is absolutely free, and there is lots and lots to enjoy, really great treasures for you and your creative heart. And on June 22nd, I'm going to be hosting this season's studio forum, and we're going to talk about our art stories. So what are the stories we're carrying with us about ourselves as creatives, as artists? What are the stories that are bolstering us, encouraging us, you know, making us feel proud and ready to go, making us empowered and able to believe in ourselves? You know, and what are the stories that are maybe holding us back? Something we may have heard when we were 12 that we're still holding on to as fact right now. Maybe someone told you you couldn't sing or you couldn't dance or you couldn't draw, and so you still don't do it, even though it might be something that interests you. It might be something that you would thoroughly enjoy. I gotta tell you one thing is all of the arts, all of them are available to you right now. There is absolutely no reason not to dance, not to sing, not to draw, not to paint, not to write a poem. All of it belongs to you as a creative human being. There is no barrier to entry to write a poem. You could do it right now. There's no audition to sing while you're at home or walking down the street. You just sing. And I love there's an old sort of saying, if only the birds that sang best sang, the forest would be an awfully quiet place. And that's not to say that you aren't going to sing the best, or maybe you do sing the best and you're loud. But also, you don't have to. I don't know, we grow up with this idea, maybe it's because we come to the arts often through school, and in school we are being assessed. And that's not really what it's about. It is about expressing yourself. It is about experience the physical, practical joy of being in communion with an art, of feeling the power you have in yourself to create right here, right now, with whatever you have, whoever you are. You have the capacity to create right now. You know, I am taking this class in art school this summer, and the art school I'm going to is not one where you need to apply or bring in a portfolio or anything like that. Last time I took a class there, which was a couple of years ago, it took all of my bravery to go, because I had so many stories about art school and I had so many stories about me, and they didn't necessarily mesh. And since then, I've still been thinking, like, I've had this idea about what would it be like to go to one of the major art colleges, which is here in Toronto. Like, what would it be like? Would that be a dream come true? And I had thought it would be. And then the other night I was out with my mastermind group, and you may have heard me talk about them on Creative Living with Jamie yesterday. I hope you checked it out. I interviewed the artist Otto Cano, and she shared a lot about how art has helped her work with her bipolar instead of against it. And there's a fascinating discussion. I hope you check it out. And just before I interviewed Otto yesterday, I shared about my mastermind group. And one of the things that came up is one of my friends has gone back to graduate school. And though she is completely fascinated with the topic she's studying, she talked about how hard it was to be a student again, and just the rigor and the demands of writing papers and tests and things like that. And that really had me thinking about, would I like to go to that kind of art school, or is the one I'm going to just right? And I think that where I am is just right. When you're going to school to establish your career, I think there is a certain sense in going through that rigmarole of assessment. And it's not for you, really, as much as it's for the world out there to say, okay, I got it. You know this. You know, I got it. You have gone through these trials, and so we know that you are knowledgeable about and can do this. And that is just so that there can be a bridge between your skills, abilities, and experience and the career world's needs. That is not where I am, and that is not what I am doing. It's not that I'm not willing to write a paper or write a test. I'm always willing to do the work, but that's not the work that's actually required for where I, on my journey, am going to go. So it's just interesting to think about, one, reassessing dreams that you've had, really paying attention to, is that something you're carrying around with you that has become, instead of like a balloon floating above with you going, yes, one day, is it kind of like sunk and turn into something else? Is it taking up space that is no longer required? That's a little bit how I felt about that. And it felt so free to realize that I am in an entirely different place. And for me, it had a little bit of a flavor of letting go of needing to prove. That is so much lighter now. So I am delighted by that. And I encourage you to think about, are there dreams you've been carrying around with you that maybe don't serve anymore, that maybe aren't right for you anymore? Or is there like a slight tweak in that dream, a little shift in it, that can make it available to you right here, right now, and maybe fit you even better than what you were thinking? We can get very like fixated. And there's a lot of books and experts out there that'll tell you this is the way to make your dreams come true. Have your eye on the prize. Don't let go of it. Just keep focused. Don't let anything get in the way. And you know, we magpies, we can have a hard time getting distracted. And so there's times when this is crucial, but sometimes it stops you from saying, oh my goodness, that is even better. Or, oh my gosh, do I even like this anymore? All I'm doing is churning my feet. I forgot what I'm doing this for. Every now and then, maybe seasonally, you know, this season thing really, really works. You know, seasonally, take a moment to assess, is everything that I'm putting my time and energy into, is it actually what I want? Like, let me just check in to see, do I still want this? Are these dreams that I'm waiting to do, is there time and space and a way that I can make them be a part of my life maintenant, right now? And are there things that it's time to let go of? Not because I'm giving up, not because I'm not devoted, but because it's just not the same anymore. You know, it's like I think about if I had been hankering over a pair of bell bottoms and it took me 10 years to save up for them, you know, and then I was finally like, yay, I got them, yay. And they're like, oh, they're not as cool to me as they used to be. So I hope that gives you lots to think about today. A couple of resources to check out if they seem good to you. Again, I'll talk about them more when I do the Creative Living Bookshelf. I just got them, but I wanted to share them with you. And Journal Clovers, I will see you in a few hours. I'm so excited. If you're a member of the studio, you'll get a newsletter from me on Sunday. And whether you are or whether you aren't, have a wonderful weekend. Get up to something wonderfully creative. Take even like a little step towards your dreams. And I will see you on Monday. Oh, and happy June!